Hi, this is Gary with MacMost.com. Let me show you how to use numbers to keep track of a simple list of items, like members in an organization or perhaps the books that you own. MacMost is supported by more than 500 viewers just like you. Go to MacMost.com/Patreon. There you could read more about the Patreon campaign, join us, and get exclusive content and course discounts. So I know when I usually talk about numbers, I'm talking about functions and formulas and calculations that you could do. But it doesn't have to be that complex. Numbers is the best app for keeping track of lists of items. So let's say you want to keep track of members in an organization. Could be a team, could be your company, could be a church group. You just want to have a list where there's names, contact information, and other notes about the member. Or maybe you want to track all of the DVDs you own or books you own. You can use numbers to do this, and you don't need to get into anything complex like functions or formulas at all. So the first example is going to be a simple membership list. We'll start with a blank template here and use the default table to get started. Now tables are made up of cells. You select a cell by clicking the cell. There are columns and rows. The columns have letter names and the rows have number names. So each cell is identified by a letter and a number like B2 or D7. Notice the first row, row 1, is darker than the rest. This is called a header row. And we use that to label the rows. So for instance, the first row could be name. The second row could be phone. Third row maybe joined for the date joined. Then maybe address and active, whether or not the member is active. The first column is also darker than the other columns. And this is called a header column. And usually we have the identifier for the row there. In the case of members, this would be the person's name. If we were keeping a list of, say, DVDs you owned, it would be the title of the DVD. So let's enter in a name here. When I'm done typing in a cell, I can hit Return or Tab. Return will go to the cell below. Tab will go to the cell to the right. So when you're entering data across in a row, you're going to want to use tabs to go all the way to the end. Let me add some sample data. So I've got a phone number here. I have a date here, an address, and then a number, 0 for not active, 1 for active. Now notice a few things. If I click on the name here and I look at the bottom left, it says this is text and it shows what the text is. If I click here, it shows text and what the text is. If I click here, it shows actual, which means an actual value, in this case a date. So it doesn't represent that as text, those characters. It actually knows that that means October 17th, 2009. This is text. And this is actual. It knows it's a number. Now I have some extra columns here. I could use the circle with two lines at the end to shrink the table to get rid of those extra columns. Likewise, I could use this circle here at the bottom left corner of the table to shrink all the way up to the top so I can get rid of the extra rows. The idea here is each row is going to represent a different member. When you talk about databases, this is the same as a record. So let me enter in some more data. With this cell selected, I can hit return and I get a new line and I can start typing in new data. So now I've got a good set of sample data in here. At the top you can see it says table 1. There's this special field here at the top of a table that allows you to give it a name. So I'm going to select that and name this table members. Now notice some of the dates here look different. I've got 02 here for the year and 2018 here for the year. I want there to be a consistent format for all of these. So I'm going to select all of these cells. I can do that by selecting the first cell and shift selecting, say, the last cell. But an easier way to do it is to click on the letter at the top of the column to select the entire column. But I don't want this header cell here. So instead, double click on it and it selects only the value cells, not the header cell. Now I can go over to the right sidebar. If you don't see it, click Format and then click Cell and you'll see Data Format. And here it says Multiple because indeed there are multiple formats. But if I select that, I can say I want specifically to use Date and Time and I want the date to be this format here and Time None. If I put a time there, you can see all of them are set to 12 a.m. because the actual value there is a specific time. So I want it to be none and just show the actual dates. Now I can also use formatting for other columns for other things. For instance, for column E here, if I double click on that, I select all the values there. Instead of using automatic or number as the format to get zeros and ones, I can select checkbox. And what checkbox gives me is a check wherever there's a one and no check when there's a zero. To make it even easier, I can now click on it to change the value. So instead of having to enter in a 1 or a 0, I could do that. The checkbox is one of the many special formats that you could use here, and it's particularly useful in cases like this. Now you can also use the sidebar to change other types of formatting. So for instance, if I wanted to change the look of some text, like select a cell here, I can go to text and then change the font, whether it's bold or not, the colors, make it italics, all sorts of things. That's for that one cell. If I wanted to do it for the entire column, I can just double click on the letter there at the top. Now I have all of those selected and I can make the change. So I can change the text color, say, to something like that. And I could change other things like make it centered, even center it vertically inside the cells. So this works just like if you're working in a word processing app. Now you may notice that these addresses here are multiple lines. But that doesn't work if you actually try to type it. Here's what you get if you try to type it. I'm going to hit delete to delete the value in there. And then type the street. And if I hit return to then go to the next line to enter the city, you can see it just advances to the next cell below it. Instead of return, you want to hold the option key down and hit return. And that will give you a line break inside of the cell. And now you can type a second line and continue to type if you need to. You can include whole paragraphs of things in there. Now I showed you how to select an entire column by clicking on the column letter at the top. You can also select a row by clicking on the number here to the left. Click it once to select. And once you've selected it, you can click and drag that row up or down to move it. You can also select multiple rows by clicking and dragging to select a range, or you can click once and then shift click somewhere else to select a range. Once you have a range selected, you could click on any of them and move the entire bunch as a group. Another handy thing to do is to go to Format Table and turn on Alternating Row Color. And this changes slightly the color of each row, and it's easier for us to visually then look across a row of data. Now you can also move columns. So I can select column C here and I could drag and move that over. So joined is after address, so it makes a little more sense. I can also sort pretty easily. If I move my cursor over the top here, you can see these little arrows that appear. If I click on one of those arrows, I have a lot of options. So I can sort ascending by column A. It would have made more sense if I had used last name, comma, first name for the names, or a separate column for last name and first name so I can sort by last name. I could sort by date as well, so I can sort here ascending and see the members by date they joined. If you need to insert something like add an extra column, there's also an option for that here. Add column before, add column after. You can also delete a column if you want. The same thing for rows. I could click here and I could add a row above or below this row or delete a row. Now here's another example. I've created a very similar looking table. I've titled the table My Books. And instead of names, I have book titles. Then I've got other columns for author, format, date read, rating, and then a column for notes. I've done some things here with the formatting. For instance, for dates, these dates here are at real dates like December 17, 2015, but they display as month and year. So if I look at the format for all of these, I can see I've got it set to date and time, but the format set to month and year. For ratings, instead of checkboxes, I've done star ratings. So you've got that as an option right there under checkbox. And you can easily set a number between 1 and 5 by clicking in here on the spot with the star. And for format here, I've chosen a pop-up menu as the format. And you get to create this little list here. And that way you can easily just click in here and then choose one of the options. Notes is a handy column to have, and I certainly could have added that to the member database as well, just to add any extra text that you need. I can now sort this list by date read, but I could also sort it by things like rating. Sorting by rating descending will give me my favorite books. One great thing about creating numbers documents for this stuff is that you can get numbers for iOS as well. So you can have numbers on your iPhone and on your iPad, and then you save this document to iCloud Drive, and now you have access to it everywhere that you go. So if you want to see a list of books you own while you're in a bookstore, you can bring up your numbers spreadsheet. If you want to get contact information for a member in your organization, you can bring up that document and look in there on your iPhone while you're out. I publish new tutorials every weekday. Hit the subscribe button so you don't miss out. Then hit the little bell icon to get notifications for each new tutorial.